This module is on qualitative analysis, and particularly how to separate cations that are in a solution from each other, or at least into groups. So this flowchart pretty much summarizes it. These are all of the major cations that you commonly see in a solution. Let's say we had a solution that had all of these cations in it. What we're going to talk about here is how we can separate them into groups. Group 1 contains silver, lead 2, and mercury 1. Group 2 contains these, copper 2, bismuth 3, etc. Group 4, group 5, and group 6. And so what we do is, okay, we have a beaker, let's say, and we have all of these cations in there. Well, first we add some hydrochloric acid. What this does is this causes any of the insoluble chlorides to precipitate out. So remember, most of the chlorides are soluble, but there are some insoluble ones, particularly silver, mercury 1, and lead 2. And so what you'll do is you'll get a precipitate, a solid, forming in the bottom of your container that has these in it. And what you can do is you can, I guess you can filter it, but usually you centrifuge it, pour off, decant the solution, and leave the solids behind. Then what you have in the beaker are groups 2, 3, 4, and 5. And so what you do is you take these guys and you add hydrogen sulfide. And what that does is that, now remember, this is an acidic solution. So remember, sulfides, the ones that are really, you know, insoluble, they'll precipitate out under acidic conditions, but the ones that are more soluble will not precipitate out until it's basic. So we get the group 2. These are the acid insoluble sulfides, the ones that have real small KSPs, right? So that's all these guys right here. So again, we get a solid, centrifuge it, decant off the liquid, and what we have left is group 3, 4, and 5. Next, we just add some sodium hydroxide, and that will precipitate out as sulfides, the ones that are base insoluble, as well as any hydroxides that are in there, any insoluble hydroxides like aluminum hydroxide, iron 3 hydroxide, chromium 3 hydroxide. And so we get group 3, these guys right here. Now we have groups 4 and 5 still in that beaker. So, you know, centrifuge it, decant the liquid, set the solid aside. Now we have the last two groups left. Now we add sodium carbonate, you know, and a soluble carbonate. Potassium carbonate probably would work as well. And we get the insoluble carbonates, which are barium, the alkaline earth metal carbonates, barium, calcium, and magnesium, leaving behind just the alkaline metal ions, sodium, potassium, and ammonium. Now what we can do here, okay, so first of all, there's going to be sodium in here because of the sodium hydroxide and sodium carbonate. But you know, you can test for sodium. I guess you could test up here, probably the best thing to do. Test up here for sodium best by doing a flame test. All you do is you take a wire, a platinum wire, clean it, and in acid, and dip it into the solution and put it into a flame. If you get a flame this color, an orange-yellow flame, that tells you that sodium is present. That's real hard to miss. You can also test for potassium. If you do the same test back up here, and when you dip it into the flame, put it into the flame, you see a purplish flame, violet, I guess. That's the indication that you have potassium. So we've separated the group 1 with hydrochloric acid, group 2, the insoluble sulfides with hydrogen sulfide, group 3, we added sodium hydroxide and got the base insoluble sulfides and hydroxides to precipitate out. Then we added carbonate, sodium carbonate, to get the insoluble carbonates, and we had left alkali metal ions and ammonium in solution.